والله يدعو إلى دار السلام ويهدي من يشاء إلى صراط مستقيم.
بسم الله، الحمد لله، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. All praise is due to Allah. We thank Him, we seek His help, His guidance, and His forgiveness. We believe in Him and we trust Him. We seek refuge in Almighty Allah from the evil of our passions. Indeed, whomsoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides him to Al-Islam, no one can mislead him after Allah. And whomsoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put him astray, no one can guide him after Allah. I testify openly that there is no deity worthy of worship except Allah Rabbil Alameen. And I testify that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his messenger and the seal of all the prophets. O Muslims, you must know that the best speech is the speech of Almighty Allah, which is the Quran. The best guidance is the course of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which is his sunnah. The worst of all affairs is innovation and addition to the religion of Al-Islam. Indeed, every addition to the religion of Al-Islam will lead to hellfire. I adjure you as well as myself to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the best of your ability. Fear Allah and don't die unless you are in the state of Al-Islam. After this, I greet you all with the greeting of Al-Islam. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May the peace and the blessing of Almighty Allah be with you all. Welcome to you all for another segment with classical reading. We're reading today from book Riyad al-Salihin, the book of Garden of the Righteousness for Imam al-Nawawi. May Allah send mercy on his soul. Ameen. Today, inshallah, we have a new chapter, which is something supposed to be from main characteristic of the Muslim, Babul Muraqabah, to be a watching and be mindful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Al-Muraqabah to mean to watch, to be mindful, to be aware that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is watching over you. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala stated, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَخْفَ عَلَيْهِ شَيْءٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَلَا فِي السَّمَاءِ. Surah Ala Imran, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in this verse number 5, say, nothing is hidden from Allah in the heaven or in the earth. Indeed, nothing is hidden from Allah. So if you know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is well acquainted, well aware, and He is Sami' and Basir, He's watching and He's looking, and He's acquainted with everything, nothing can be hidden from Him in the heaven or in the earth. And you are one of these things that in the creation of Allah, small, tiny thing among the big creation and creature of Allah's creation. Subhanallah. So if you know that your Allah is watching over you, what kind of a behavior, what kind of attitude are you supposed to have as a Muslim? It is very important that we always remember that Allah is watching over us. And if every Muslim, male and female, try to keep this in mind, their life will be better than what they are today. Their future will be better. Everything will change. Why? Because the muraqabah and the watching and being aware and knowing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala watching, hearing, seeing us, our action, now is going to put a fear in your heart. It's going to slow you down from things that you're doing or saying that you are not supposed to be doing or saying. And this is something, like I said, one of the main characteristics of the Muslim and the believer that is supposed to be in him, or that we're struggling and we're trying our best to develop this kind of characteristic in our personality so we can be a better Muslim, inshallah. Always remember that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala watching over you. Always remember that nothing is hidden from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The hadith which is well known and famous by Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, and he told us about one day he was sitting with in the gathering of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. اصطلع علينا رجل شديد بياض الثياب شديد سواد الشعر لا يعرف منا احد ولا يرى عليه اثر السفر. And describe this man appear suddenly, white hair, black hair. You could not tell that he's a traveler, but he's a stranger to us. And he came and he said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he questioned him. One of the questions that he asked about Islam, Iman, and one of the main questions he asked about what? Al-Ihsan. Excellency. What is Ihsan? What was the reply of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? أن تعبد الله كأنك تراه. فإن لم تكن تراه فإنه يراك. Now we talk about Islam, we talk about Iman and the principles and all these things, but comes about Ihsan, this is al-muraqabah. This now to reach to the level of aware that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is watching over you. Worship Allah as if you are looking into Him, He's in front of you. And we, as we understand, we could not see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this life. And seeing Allah is possible. And if it's not possible, the Prophet Musa alayhi salam was not going to ask Allah. Because the Prophet Musa, he said, قَالَ رَبِّ أَرِنِي أَنظُرْ إِلَيْكَ. Oh Allah, give me this opportunity. Let me look at you. Allah said, he didn't say, I could not be seen. He said, لَن تَرَانِي. You could not, because the problem is with us, that our ability, we could not see Allah, because we are not prepared in this dunya to see Allah. But inshallah, in the akhirah, Allah will bless us with this opportunity that we can look at Him and see Him. So now Islam telling you that you want to reach this level. You got your master degree, now we're asking, you try to get your PhD degree, now you need to get a post-doctor degree. You keep going in level of education. We want you also to go in level of Iman until you reach it to the level of Ihsan. What is the level of Ihsan and excellency? That you worship Allah as if you're looking at Him. And you know if your manager or your boss or the policeman, you know you're driving, you're supposed to be driving 60 miles an hour. But now he is zooming on the highway 80 miles an hour. When do you slow down? Now when you see the policeman, it put fear in you. You slow down, you hit the brake immediately. You know, we do it sometimes, okay? Not all the time, sometimes. So we won't come to this kind of realization that we always understand Allah is there, that I'm looking at it, He see me. But if my Iman, my faith is so weak, I could not come to this feeling and this realization, فَعْلَمْ أَنَّهُ يَرَكْ. If you could not develop this ability that you worship Allah, when you make salah, when you fast, when you walk in the street, when you buy, when you sell, when you deal with your family, as if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you are looking at Him. So that means you monitor in yourself, your behavior, your talk, your action. Why? Because my master, my creator is looking at me. I'm seeing Him. This has to be the feeling in your heart. But if you could not come to this realization, now be aware that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is looking at you. He hears you. He sees you. So try to improve yourself and try to clean your act, inshallah. The advice of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which he gave it to Mu'adh, may Allah be pleased with him. He said, ittaqillaha haythuma kunt. Ittaqillaha haythuma kunt. Wa atbi' as-sayyi'at al-hasanata tamhuha. Wa khaliq an-nasa bi khuluq hasan. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave advice to one of the companions by name Mu'adh. He said, fear Allah wherever you are. Fear Allah wherever you are. And it's so sad that some people, when they leave Arabia, reach America, no more salah. Why? You worship in your country or you worship in Allah? If you worship in Allah, Allah see you in America or in Arabia. Some women, I saw them with my own eyes. I don't want to say what country. But the moment they get inside the aeroplane, they take the hijab, they take the abaya off. Subhanallah. The hijab is obligational. Islam not is a habit, is not a customer. It's not something that we do it as a part of a culture. So if I'm in Arabia, now I put the abaya, cover my face as soon as I get in the aeroplane. Now everything is exposed. Astaghfirullah. Why? Allah doesn't see you in the aeroplane. Allah doesn't see you in... So the advice of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, fear Allah. Wherever you go, wherever you are. If the room is dark or light, Allah still see you. Subhanallah. We need to think about these things. It's not a matter of memorizing hadith and telling the hadith. We need to start to think about these things. We need this to be reality in our life, to come to realization that Allah sees us. This is what we call muraqabah, that Allah is watching over me and I have to get this feeling. اتق الله حيث ما كنت. Fear Allah. Stay away from the haram, wherever you are. Do the right thing, wherever you are. Oh, brother, there is a conference, and if I start to make my prayer, they will think I'm a terrorist or I'm a fundamentals. No, let me understand, stay in the conference and be talking with everybody and shaking hands with women, you understand? Compromise. Darihim ma dumta fi darihim. Doesn't work like this. This is not the way. Wherever you are, you need to fear Allah by doing what is right and stay away from what is haram. And what else the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said? وَأَتْبِعِ السَّيِّئَةَ الْحَسَنَةَ تَمْحُهَا. Whenever you do something wrong, when you commit a sin, follow up with something good. Why? This will erase it. Subhanallah. Alhamdulillah is a great ni'mah that Allah made a way for salvation and a way for forgiveness for us in Islam. You don't need somebody to be on the cross for you to be forgiven. Be sincere and be serious. Do a good deed. Go make wudu and make two rak'at. Allah will forgive you. Say astaghfirullah. Go give a charity. Help a poor or a needy person. So this was Islam telling us. This one of the ways how to cleanse ourselves. How to destroy and remove the sins that have been committed. Because we're human beings. We are not angels. We are not angels. We human beings, we're going to make mistakes. But, like you say, لَيْسَ الْعَيْبَ أَنْ تُخْطِئِ. It's not a shameful that you commit a sin. But what is the عَيْب, what is wrong, that you continue doing the wrong. So it is expected from you that you do something wrong. But how do you clean it up? This is what we're supposed to be concerned about. Whenever a moment of weakness, you do something wrong, you know you need to correct it. You need to get the wipe out and you put it over it. You need to turn the pencil and use the eraser and remove this. How? By follow it by good deed. A good deed will remove your sins. What else? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying, وَخَالِقِ النَّاسِ بِخُلُقٍ حَسَنٍ. Deal with the people in a good manner, good behavior. Subhanallah. Now we understand that Islam is what? A relationship between you and Allah. Secondly, a relationship between you and yourself. وَنَفْسٍ وَمَا سَوَّهَا فَأَلْهَمَا فُجُورَهَا وَتَقْوَاهَا. So your relationship with your soul, that you try to save it, you try to clean it, you try to purify your heart, you try to elevate your soul. This is the second relation. The third relationship between you and mankind is not enough, and this is a problem. A lot of people say, brother, all these people with beard, they understand. These people, they understand. They always have been making face like this. And these people, they understand. It's so harsh. Brother, I'm not making salah. I don't grow my beard, but my heart is good. I smile in the people's face. This is a big mistake. Nobody says that because you are having beard, you have to make a face in the people's face. You can smile. Smile is a charity on the people. It's a charity for you. Give it to the people. It's not because you have a beard, you understand that mean you have to be mean to the people. No. خَالِقِ النَّاسَ بِخُلِقٍ حَسَنٍ. And this is the beauty of Islam, the balance. A balanced relationship. A relationship between you and Allah. A relationship between you and yourself. A relationship between you and the society. What is the relationship between you and Allah? تَقْوَى Allah. What is the relationship between you and your soul? Tazkiyah, elevation. What's the relationship between you and the society? Good akhlaq, good manner. And Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her, when she been questioned about the akhlaq of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, she said what? Kana khuluqu al-Qur'an, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. His mannerism, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was Qur'an. So we need to see how to act according to the Qur'an, how we became a tafsir, not to be read, but to be seen. That would be good treatment. Be benevolent, be kind, be gentle, be nice. Because this is what Islam is about. Islam is not only about salah and a mosque. Islam is for the mosque and for the street and for the family. So we need to learn how to soft ourselves, be lenient, being forgiven with others, because this part of the wasiyah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Let's come to the next hadith, which is very important, and I would like to have your attention with me. And I know that you was watching, but I want you to now to wake up more. Listen to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam giving advice to a ghulam, a young boy, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, how he presented. Ibn Abbas, may Allah be pleased with him, he said, كنت خلف النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يوما فقال يا غلام إني أعلمك كلمات احفظ الله يحفظك احفظ الله تجده تجاهك. To the continuation, the end of the hadith. And as I told you before, you need to buy Riyad al-Salihin, Arabic and English, so you can start to read and have a session with the book at least once a week. So I'm giving you only a quotation from the beginning of the hadith, because I'm not here to read for you. I'm here to explain, break it down for you. This hadith is so beautiful, very important. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he's the Prophet of Allah, but he took this young boy a company and he gave him a ride on the donkey. And he took this opportunity to teach him. He say, oh young man, I want to teach you something that Allah will benefit you with it. What it is? He said, احفظ الله يحفظك. Guard Allah's limits. In actuality, the hadith say, guard Allah, Allah will guard you. But this is rough translation. How I can guard Allah? Allah doesn't need a protection. Allah doesn't need anybody to guard him. That means guard the limits of Allah. احفظ الله يحفظك. If you guard the limits of Allah, that means you do what Allah said do, and you stay away from what Allah said don't do. This is called guarding the limits of Allah. In return, Allah will guard you. Allah will protect you. Allah will preserve you. Allah will take care of you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make a special bodyguard for you. From ins, from jinn, from other things which is harmful. This is the protection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It comes as a result of protecting his limits and guarding his limits. What else? احفظ الله تجده تجاهك. Guard the limits of Allah. You find Allah there for you. إذا سألت فاسأل الله وإذا استعنت فاستعن بالله. If you ask, ask Allah. Ask Allah. If you seek help in Allah. And this is the whole foundation of Al-Islam called Tawheed, from Wahid, oneness. This is the whole thing. If you don't have a foundation, you could not erect your building. Our foundation is Tawheed. You could not ask the people, especially dead people. It's so amazing, it's so strange. People worship in graves, worshiping dead people. And people go over the grave and crying, say, oh, see this so-and-so, please, my wife, you understand? Or, subhanAllah, a'udhu billah, how you crying and calling in a dead person? وَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى الْحَيِّ الَّذِي لَا يَمُوتُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the living one who never die. Why are you calling on a dead person? And even if this person is not dead, he could not help you. Or see this so and say, oh brother, this is awliya Allah. This is the friends of Allah. Fine. But listen, why you jumping the gun? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi, I'm telling you what the Prophet saying. Don't give me a logic. Don't make a common sense. Tell him, oh, because they are awliya Allah and they're the friends of Allah. Yes, they are awliya Allah. But the Prophet didn't say to you, ask them, beg them. The Prophet say what? إِذَا سَأَلْتَ فَاسْأَلِ اللَّهِ وَإِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. This is the deen of tawheed. The deen of oneness. Worship Allah alone. Not to pray to Allah. And after this, you ask somebody else. You could not do this. I can ask you to give me a cup of yansoon, as example, cup of tea, some water, help me understand to lift this or to fix my tire. Yeah, because this is in your means. You can help me with it. But don't ask a human being, dead or alive, things that is not in their capacity. الَّذِي يُطْعِمُنِي وَيَسْقِينَ وَإِذَا مَرِضْتُ فَهُوَ يَشْفِينَ. Okay? Even the doctor could not heal you. The healing is from Allah, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who going to make the effect in the medicine to heal you. So you taking this as means, but the one who heal you, the one who make you satisfied, content, is not the food, is Allah. So how you can ask a dead person, oh, my wife only have boys, I need a girl, or my wife have girls, I need a boy, oh, see this so and so, bless my wife. Let my wife have a girl. Let my wife have a boy. This is called shirk. This is called shirk. Inna shirka la zulmun azim. You're transgressing against Allah. And this is something very serious. So now back again to what the Prophet saying. Either sa'alta fas'allah. I don't want to hear your common sense. And 1+1=2. And they try to get a logic. Because there are awliya Allah. They are friends. They used to be a big sheikh and big maulana. I don't need this. I want to hear from the Prophet. I want to hear from the Prophet. What the Prophet said? إِذَا سَأَلْتَ فَاسْأَلِ اللَّهِ وَإِذَا اسْتَعَنْتَ فَاسْتَعِنْ بِاللَّهِ. If you ask, ask Allah alone. If you seek help in Allah and alone. وَعْلَمْ. Listen now. Listen now. This is something very important. This now a part of عقيدة. وَعْلَمْ أَنَّ الْأُمَّةِ الْأُمَّةِ لَوْ اجْتَمَعَتْ. If the whole nation, the whole community get together to benefit you with something, they could not benefit you with anything unless something Allah had decreed for you. And if they get together to harm you with something, they could not harm you with anything unless something been decreed against you. My dear respected brothers and sisters, everything in the hand of Allah. Death and life in the hand of Allah. Happiness in the hands of Allah. Don't think anybody can fire you from the work because you are a Muslim. You understand? If Allah doesn't decree it, it's not going to happen to you. They can hit your guts, but if they try to fire you and Allah didn't decree it, it's not going to happen. We have to have this belief in Allah. That he is the only one has la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. There is no power or might except by Allah. Don't look to the people nothing but an agent in the hand of Allah. The true one behind everything is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Be aware that if the whole nation get together to benefit you with something, they could not benefit you with anything unless something Allah had decreed for you. And if they get together to harm you with something, they could not harm you with anything unless that something Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had decreed against you. What is the end of this beautiful hadith? رفعت الأقلام وجفت الصحف. The pen been lifted and the ink been dry. قلم القدرة. What Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had decreed, اكتب. Allah had revealed to the pen to write. And is already been written in the Lawh al-Mahfuz, in the protect tablet. Nothing changed. People could not change, could not harm you, could not benefit you. Okay? So we have to have aqidah in Allah. Believe in the qadr of Allah. Look to the people like a nothing except a tool in the hand of Allah, he can move it in any direction he wants. I believe in what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decreed, and that no one can harm me except Allah. So put your trust in Allah and be aware that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only one can harm or benefit, and that the ink been dry and the pen been lifted. Now we have to be careful about certain things that we do, that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it may doesn't prove it. We have to be watchful for Allah. And sometimes, and give you a common things that Muslims do things, like women going without hijab, men shaving their beard every day, people neglecting salah. And listen to this. Anas, may Allah be pleased with him, he said, إِنَّكُمْ لَتَعْمَلُونَ أَعْمَالًا هِيَ أَدَقُّ فِي أَعْيُنِكُمْ مِنَ الشَّعْرِ كُنَّا نَعُدُّهَا عَلَى عَهْدِ النَّبِي صلى الله عليه وسلم مِنَ الْمُبِيقَاتِ. I swear, you do certain acts. You violate the law of Allah. And things to you like nothing, like a hair, piece of hair. But we used to consider them in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam destructive issues. So be careful of these small sins, shaving beard, not having hijab, not making salah in time, because all these things will build up and can destroy us as Muslims. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us among those who have muraqabah, watching Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us a good ending. Ameen. And with this, inshallah, we end this chapter. Until I see you next time, thank you for watching. This is Muhammad Said Adli from Columbia, South Carolina, United States. Ameen.